Yes guys, let's read through the 21st problem. The following is a summarized balance sheet of Ram, Sham and Tom as on 31st March 2012. There's some equity shares, general reserve, a P&L account and current liability is given to you with three investments, Ram and Sham, Ram and Tom and Sham and Tom. So again a chain holding problem. But a chain holding with different dates of acquisition is what we're going to see. The following information, prepare a consolidated balance sheet of Ram Limited and its subsidiaries as on 31st March 2012. Sham Limited has advanced 8 lakhs to Tom. The current liabilities of Ram Limited includes 4 lakhs due to Tom. Sham and Tom have not paid any dividends. Ram Limited acquired the investments on 1/4/2011 from Sham Limited and then amount standing to the credit of general reserve and the P&L was 2,80,000 and 5,20,000. So Ram's acquisition is on in Sham is on 1/4/2011. Ram acquired investments in Tom on the same day 1/4/2011 when the debit balance in the P&L account was 4,80,000 negative reserve. Sham Limited acquired investments in Tom on 1/4/2009 when the debit balance in the P&L was 1,60,000. Sham Limited stock includes stock worth 4,80,000 invoiced by Ram at 20% above cost. So this is an upstream transaction because Sham Limited, is a downstream transaction because it is Sham Limited stock includes stock worth 4,80,000 invoiced by Ram. That means holding company selling it to its subsidiary, it becomes a downstream transaction and adjustment only in your reserves for CBS. So until then you won't have this adjustment at all. So if you basically on 1/4/2011, so two different dates of acquisition, we need to start redistribution. So only for this part, so let's start the problem. There's no adjustments as far as the problem is concerned. Date of acquisition, Ram and Sham, 1/4/2011. Ram and Tom, same day, 1/4/2011. But Sham and Tom was acquired on 1/4/2009 itself. This gives you multiple dates of acquisition. Because when we analyze Tom as pre-acquisition and post-acquisition, we have two dates of acquisition. So we have to analyze with respect to the first date. And then we'll start redistribution with respect to 1/4/2011. So this is a multiple dates of acquisition, guys. Shareholding pattern. Number of shares held and percentage holding. First for Sham Limited, it's only held by Ram and minority. Number of shares in Sham, check Sham's share capital. Sham's share capital is 4000, each share of 100 rupees, so I can write this as 40. All rupees in thousands. 32,000 shares are held by Ram. So this is 32 and minority is 8. So this will give me 80% and 20% share. Then the indirect subsidiary Tom, held by Ram, Sham, and even minority. number of shares in term, 1600 shares, each share of 100 rupees each, so 16 shares. Out of the 16 shares, check the number of shares held by Ram in term, 4 shares, Shyam in term, 12 shares. We are writing everything in thousands. 4, 12, so there is no minority at all. I don't have any minority interest, guys. Entire holding is held by Ram and Shyam. 4 is 25% and 12 is 75%. There is no minority interest. When we start the third step analysis, we need to start with compulsory, the indirect subsidiary, that is TOM. Analysis of reserves of TOM Limited with respect to date of first acquisition. What is the first acquisition in TOM? Out of these two dates, 1/4/2009 looks to be the first date of acquisition. In TOM Limited, if you observe, there's only one reserve. Check, on the liability side, there's nothing. But on the asset side, I have a P&L of 640. That is a debit balance or a negative P&L. That is the only reserve which is existing there. P&L balance as on 31st March 2012 is 640. I am analyzing with respect to 1409, so I need to check what is the balance on 1409. Balance as on 1st April 2009. Check 1st April 2009 balance. Given in point number 6, Shyam Limited acquired investments in TOM on 1409 and then the debit balance in your P&L was 160. I'm writing everything in thousands. This 640 is a negative figure. This 160 is also a negative figure. So, losses subsequent to acquisition . All these are accumulated losses subsequent to acquisition. 640 minus 160 is 480. 480 again negative. There's nothing to be done as an adjustment from this. Everything looks plain. There's no adjustment which is given from the reserves of this company. So, ultimately whenever I go to the distribution table, again I have to take up the same figures. So, let's start distributing here itself. This for 160 we'll call it as pre-acquisition. 480 can be called as post-acquisition. Let's distribute. It is 25-75 between Ram and Shyam. So Ram 25%, 1 by 4 is 40. Shyam 75% is 120 for pre-acquisition. Post-acquisition, Ram is 120. Shyam is 360. Everything is a negative figure, guys. They are negative P&L or losses. Now, out of the analysis that we have done, we are trying to identify between pre and post based on 1409. But check your date of acquisition for Ram and Tom. Ram and Tom's acquisition is 1411. Shyam in term 1409 is correct. So whatever Shyam shares we got as pre-acquisition and post-acquisition, they are absolutely right. Because we have analyzed with respect to their date of acquisition. What is wrong? The wrong one is only with the Ram. Because Ram we have analyzed with respect to 1/4/2009, my date of acquisition is actually 1/4/2011. There's 2 years in between, so we have to start redistributing the profits. So redistribution. redistribution of reserves of term limited with respect to date of acquisition by RAM. Only RAM share we have to consider. Check only RAM shares. Maintain two columns, pre-acquisition column and post-acquisition column. And let's start redistributing. Take only RAM limited share. What is RAM limited share in pre-acquisition? Pre-acquisition is 40. Post-acquisition is 120. Both negatives. This we got when we analyzed with respect to 1-4-2009. But his date of acquisition is 1-4-2011. So let's start redistributing. Redistribution with respect to second acquisition, that is 1-4-2011. What was the percentage holding acquired? It was Ram who acquired in Tom at that point of time. So Ram and Tom acquisition of percentage is 25. So my P&L from 1-4-2009 up to 1-4-2011. We have to check these two. From the date of first acquisition up to the date of subsequent acquisition. What is the P&L? Check. On 1-4-2009, Tom Limited's P&L was 160. But exactly in the point number 5 above, he says that Ram acquired investments in Tom on 1-4-2011 when the debit balance was 480. So 160 became 480 within 2 years. So how much is the loss? 480 minus 160, 320. Guys, this is negative figure. It's a loss. It's a loss. Everything is losses. Everything is a debit balance. So how much should be the redistribution now? So 320 into 25% should be the redistribution. Guys, normally what we do? We reduce it from post, we add it to pre. If it was profit. But now this is loss. I can't do that. So whenever it is loss, we deduct it from post. Or we deduct it from pre, we add it to post. How much? 320 into 25% is 80. Reduce from pre, add to post. We have done the reverse if it was a profit. We are doing it the other way around because it's a loss. So this will become 120 negative and this will become 40 negative. So if you observe, basically the figures got swapped. Between pre and post acquisition, just the figures got swapped. Now these are the shares of Ram Limited in Tom Limited which should be considered. Check for Sham now. Is there any adjustment as far as Sham Limited is concerned? Ram Limited acquired investments on 1-4-2011 from Sham. Then the amount standing to the credit of general reserve and P&L is directly given to you. You know balance sheet figures. You know date of acquisition figures. There is no particular adjustment that we have to do from this. So directly go for the distribution table for Sham. Distribution of reserves of Sham. Maintain two columns. Pre and post. I have two reserves there. One is a general reserve. Other one being a P&L. Check general reserve. Balance sheet date, Sham Limited balance is 280. Everything is in thousands. 280. On the date of acquisition, that is existing on 1/4/2011, if you observe, how much is in 280 again? So what does it mean? That means the entire 280 should be written under pre column. Post acquisition will only have P&L column. So general reserve is 280 and nil. P&L 960 is what is given in the balance sheet. On the date of acquisition in point number 4, it was 520. So 520 on the date of acquisition, 960 to be written there. 960, what do we write then? We'll write it as 440. Because it is 960 minus 520. If you add these two, we get again back the 960 figure, which is the amount of P&L there. But do not forget one more item. Whenever you have chain holdings to distribute Sham Limited, we have to add Sham Limited share in post acquisition reserves of TOM. Check. Sham Limited share in post acquisition reserves of TOM, negative 360. Strike, this will be 800 and this is 80. Sham Limited distribution, check Sham Limited. Ram holds 80, minority holds 20. Ram holds 80%. Minority holds 20%. 80%, 640, 64, no, 160, 64, 16, and there we have the figures. My distribution is over, so we can directly go for your cost of control, minority interest, reserves for CVS, and then balance sheet. There is no dividend adjustment at all in cost of control. Plain simple problem, guys. But we have three columns. Ram in Sham. Ram in Tom. Sham in Tom. We'll have three columns to handle with. Start with your cost of investments. Check asset side, investments. Ram in Sham, 4800. Ram in Tom, 200. Sham in Tom, 720. No dividend, no pre-acquisition dividend, nothing. Directly share in net assets. Compare with share in net assets on the date of acquisition. So we'll split this between share capital and pre-acquisition reserve. Chalo, share capital. Each share is 100 rupees. Based on that, you'll start calculating. Ram in Sham holds 32 shares. Share capital is 3200. Ram in Tom, he holds 4 shares, 400. Sham in Tom, 12 shares, 1200. Pre-acquisition reserves, Ram in Sham, 640. Ram in Tom, we just got the figures. After redistribution, it is 120 negative. Sham in Tom, pre-acquisition, again 120 negative. Sham in Tom, no redistribution, guys. Direct figure from the distribution where we have done. Sham in Tom is minus 120. So this is 3840, this is 280, and this is 1080. So let's find out the goodwills. In first case, you get a goodwill of 960. Second case, I get a capital reserve of negative 80. Third case, I get 360 negative capital reserves in the other two cases. So on a combined way, I get a goodwill of 520. That is cost of control. Go for the minority. Don't maintain two columns for minority interest. There is no minority for sham. Sorry, in term. So you get only minority interest in sham. Their share in net assets split between share capital and reserves. Minority share in reserves is split again between pre-acquisition reserve and post-acquisition reserve. That is sufficient to close. You just have to pick up the figures and place it there. Share capital. They hold each share of 100 rupees, 800. Their reserves. Check your distribution table. Minority reserves are 160 and 16. Minority total is 976. Go over your reserves for CBS. Maintain only one column, P&L sufficient. You don't have to maintain general reserve because there is no general reserve as far as distributions are concerned. So take only P&L. General reserve as it is 1600, whatever appears in the holding company appears in the consolidated balance sheet. Start with 1360 figure and check what are the adjustments. There is one adjustment that they have to do regarding your unrealized profit. Ram Limited's balance of reserve 1360. Add his share and post acquisition reserves. His share and post acquisition reserves of Shyam and Tom. In Sham, his share in post-acquisition reserve is 64. And in Tom, check your redistribution, minus 40. Unrealized profit on stock. Check. Point number 7. Stock includes stock worth 480,000 which was invoiced by Ram at 20% above cost. 480,000 is the value included in the stock. That means it is at selling price. If it is 1/5 on cost, it should be 1/6 on selling price. 1/6 on 480,000. 480,000, I'll write it as 480 because I'm writing everything in thousands. 1/6 of 480 is 80. I think this is 1304. You You have all the figures, you can go for your consolidated balance sheet. Guys, while preparing the consolidated balance sheet, there are some intercompany owings which are given in the first and the second point, totaling to 1,200,000, I guess, which needs to be reduced from both current assets as well as current liabilities. Don't forget that. Is it 1,200? Yeah, 800 and 400, writing in thousands. equity and liabilities. Shareholders' funds. Share capital. Equity share capital of Ram Limited is 8,000. Reserves and surplus. We got a goodwill, I guess. So there's only two reserves, general reserve and P&L. General reserve straightforward figure from the balance sheet is 1600. P&L figure we have done in reserves for CBS as 1304. Then your minority interest, 976. There's no non-current liabilities. I'm directly writing the current liabilities. It should be reduced by 1200 because of the first and the second point. The first and the second point require 1200 rupees of deduction to be done. So this is 4,200. Assets. Non-current assets. Tangible fixed assets. Is there any tangible fixed asset? No. But they have an intangible asset of goodwill. $520. Then go for your current assets. Current assets, we also have to reduce the unrealized profit of 80 from that. So 1200 plus 80, total 1280 reduced. I think this is 560, I guess. Balance sheet total is 16080. With that, we come to the end of the balance sheet, guys. Critical point was only the redistribution for Ram Limited in Tom Limited. Start reading the next problem. 22. Balance sheet of Bat and Ball as on 31st March 2000 is as follows. Nice needed after balance sheet given there. Only one single reserve, that is your P&L account. That's it. Investments, Bat and Ball, 1,96,000. No chain only. Straightforward. Particulars of Bat Limited. Bat is a holding company, guys. Understand clearly. The company, Bat Limited, was formed on 1409. That means exactly 1 year before. It acquired shares in Ball Limited as under. As and when it was formed on 1/4/1999, they acquired 8,000 shares at 1,10,000 rupees. On 31st July, again they acquired 6,000 shares by paying 86,000 rupees. The shares purchased on 31-7-99 are ex-dividend, ex-bonus from the existing holders. That means they are not entitled to receive any bonus, neither they are receiving any dividend at all. On 31-7-99, dividend at the rate of 10% was received from Bond Limited and was credited to P&L account. Guys, what he receives on 31-7-99 is last year's dividend, which should be considered as pre-acquisition dividend. But how many shares are entitled to receive such dividend? These 6,000 shares which are purchased on 31-7 are not entitled to dividend. So only on those 8,000 shares which were acquired on 1-4-99, they are entitled to receive a dividend from the subsidiary Ball Limited. Next, they have wrongly credited it to P&L, normal adjustment as usual. On 31-7, it received a bonus from Ball Limited in the ratio of 1 share for every 4 shares held. How many shares will Bat Limited get? Bat Limited will get only on the 8,000 shares. They will not get on the 6,000 shares. So 1 share of every 4 shares, that means they will get 2,000 shares as bonus. Bat Limited incurred an expenditure of 500 rupees per month on behalf of Ball Limited, and this was debited to the P&L of Bat. But nothing has been done in the books of Ball. It is Ball's expenditure met by Bat reduced from Bat Limited's P&L account, which is wrong. So what should I do? I need to increase Bat Limited's P&L and I have to reduce Ball Limited's P&L. Balance of P&L as on 31st March 2000 included 36,000 being net profit during the current year. That is the best part. He gave you what is the net profit of the current year. We don't know what is the previous year balance. Proposed dividend for 99-2000 of 10% has not yet been provided. Should I provide the dividend? Yes. That is holding company's dividend. Holding company's dividend we have to compulsorily provide. The balance of P&L account as on 31st March 2000 is after the issue of bonus shares made on 31-7-99. Which are talking about Ball Limited. He is saying that the P&L balance which you see in the balance sheet for Ball Limited, that is 60,000, that is after bonus. Bonus is paid out of profits. After that, it is 60,000. The net profit during the year was 24,000. Guys, 60,000 is given to you. Current year profit is 24. That means what was the balance earlier? 36. Including 6,000 received from an insurance company in settlement of a claim towards loss of stock by fire on 36-99. Guys, 36-99 is a date falling between these two dates of acquisitions. And he's saying that the cost of the goods of 10,800 were included in the opening stock. How much did he receive? 6,000. For how much cost? 10,800. That means he incurred a loss of 4,800. So after incurring a loss of 4,800, net profit made is 24,000. So if I ask you what is a uniform profit, that means I have to exclude this loss. After loss, if it is 24,000, then before loss the profit was 28,800. The 28,800 is said to be called as uniform profit throughout the year. That 4,800 is a loss which occurred on 30th June. One single day loss, that is. Got it? Which is important when we start redistributing. Dividend proposed for 99-2000 is 10%, not yet provided in the books of accounts. Prepare the consolidated balance sheet. Now, should I provide the dividend? Yes. The dividend will not be provided if it is paid out of post-acquisition profits. But here, since my date of acquisition is lying in between as well as on 31st July, so there's a portion of post-acquisition and a portion of pre-acquisition. Compulsory, we have to provide dividend. So, let's start. There are really not many adjustments, guys, except for that expenditure which he has given, which he was talking about, saying that Bat Limited spent on behalf of Ball Limited and this was debited to the P&L of Bat. Nothing done in the books of Ball. That is the only adjustment normally, because the bonus is already adjusted. That is what he said. Yes guys, so let's start. Date of acquisitions, two dates of acquisition. One date is 1/4/99. Second date is 31/7/99. After 4 months. Go for the shareholding pattern. Number of shares and percentage holding. Yes guys, let's check. Held by BAT. BAT Limited acquired on 1/4/99 8,000 shares. These 8,000 shares were entitled to a bonus. So plus bonus. 1:4 bonus. That means they'll get 2,000 shares extra. After that, on 31/7/99, again he purchased 6,000 shares. In total, what he has acquired is 16,000 shares. What is the total number of shares after bonus in Ball Limited? 20,000. So how much does minority hold? 4,000. So what he acquired initially is 8,000 plus 2,000. I want subsequent acquisitions. So total is actually 80-20. When you talk about subsequent acquisition, 6,000 of 20,000. Subsequently he has acquired 30% holding. Analysis of reserves of Ball Limited with respect to date of first acquisition. What is the date of first acquisition? 1/4/1999. There is only one reserve, that is P&L, and the balance sheet balance is 60,000. Balance as on 31st March 2000 is 60,000. We need to know what is the balance on date of acquisition. Check. My date of acquisition is first date, 1/4/99. That means 1 year before. He has given you some information which is regarding that, saying that in point number 2, the net profit made during the year was 24,000. It included 6,000 receipt for goods which were destroyed by fire or whatever. The cost of the goods were 10,800, whatever it is. My current year net profit is basically 24,000. So I strike this. This I don't know. What is the balance as on 1/4/99? I have no idea. But I know this part. Current year profit after all adjustments, whatever it is, I know that this is 24,000. That means balance at the beginning of the year should be 36,000. The 60,000 is after bonus. So obviously this 36,000 is also after bonus only. There's an adjustment. For the adjustment, you need to flip back to point number 6. BAT Limited incurred an expenditure of 5,000 per month expenditure of 500 rupees per month on behalf of Bond Limited, and this was debited to the P&L of BAT, but nothing has been done as far as the books of Bond Limited is concerned. Guys, now the first question will start asking how much of expenditure, 500 rupees per month, but how many months did he pay? There's no answer for that particular question. How many months did he pay? Remember guys, whenever we are talking about an intercompany transaction, our assumption was always same, that my transaction has happened only after he acquired controlling interest. My controlling interest is acquired on 31-7-99. My controlling interest was acquired only on 31-7-99. That means my expenditure will also be incurred only from 31-7-99. So how many months are we incurring the expenditure? August, September, October, November, December, Jan, February, March. So totally 8 months we are incurring expenditure. So reduce the amount of expenditure. Expenses incurred by BAT, 500 rupees into 8 months. 4,000. Finally, as proposed dividend, ₹20,000. 10% dividend on its share capital. Share capital is 2 lakhs. 10% dividend is 20,000. Post acquisition reserves is nil. So entire 36,000 can be called as pre-acquisition reserves. So when I have pre-acquisition, I can start distribution. There's only one reserve, so I'm directly distributing BAT and minority. BAT 80%, 28,800. Minority 7,200. Post acquisition is absolutely zero. Does it mean that we don't get post acquisition? We will get post acquisition once we start doing redistribution. We have distributed and analyzed with respect to 1499, but I have the second date of acquisition, that is 31799, which we have to start doing. Redistribution of reserves. Maintain two columns, pre-acquisition and post-acquisition. Let's start. First, let's take BAT Limited reserves, BAT Limited share and reserves of BOL. 28,800 and nil. Now I have to redistribute. With respect to second acquisition, that is 31,799. with respect to 31,799, what was the percentage holding acquired? How many shares did he acquire? 6,000. How many shares were actually then? 20,000. So 6,000 out of 20,000, what he has acquired is 30%. In the same way, I need profits earned from 14 to 31,799. This is crucial. Once you get that figure, I can place it happily. We can solve the problem. Problem is completed because the redistribution is a major part of the problem. But the problem is how to fill up this figure. The profit from 14 up to 31,799. Yes guys, how do we get profits from 14 to 317 between these dates? Now understand, first we need to get the uniform profits. What is the profit that he has given? Point number 2 in Ball Limited. Net profit is 24,000, which includes 6,000 rupees received from insurance company in settlement of a claim towards loss of stock by fire on 30th June 1999, where the cost of the goods were 10,800 included in opening stock. That means there was a loss of 4,800 exactly on this point of time. When was the date when he incurred the loss between these two? Because it is 30th June. That means it is falling year. That means that loss should be considered for this. Now, second thing, I can't say 24,000 is a profit for the entire year. Then how much is it for 4 months? I can't do that. The simple reason is because the 24,000 is not uniform profit, because it includes 4,800 rupees of a loss of abnormal item. Let's start identifying this. Profit from 14 to 31,799. Net profit for the year 99-2000 is 24,000. But this is not uniform. How do I make it uniform? Add back the abnormal loss. That means before this abnormal loss, my uniform profit is 28,800. This is for how many months? 12 months. How many months are we trying to find out? 4 months. Get. Uniform profit from 14 to 31,7. 4 months. Calculate. 28,800 into 4 by 12. This is 9,600. Out of this 9,600, there is an abnormal loss during this period. It is during the same period. That year June was the date of loss. So I am trying to identify profits from 14 to 31,7. So I need to compulsorily reduce the abnormal loss from this period. Less abnormal loss, 4,800 he incurred abnormal loss. So his balance of profit is only 4,800. Profit earned from 14,99 to 31,799. Now I am adding 4,800 once, I am deducting 4,800 once. The first reason why I added 4800 is to get uniform profit, because it is an abnormal event. So I'm getting a uniform profit throughout the year, out of which I'm identifying what is 4 months profit. Now after identifying the 4 months profit, I'm saying that this abnormal loss belongs to the period of 1/4 to 31/7. So I'm writing off the loss during that particular period. Balance of profit is 4800. Once again guys, we also have a dividend part. We also have to deduct the amount of dividend. Expenditure, no, because expenditure is incurred only after 31/7. So I won't deduct this part, because this expenditure is only incurred after 31/7. I am taking it from 1/8 to 31st March. I don't have this deduction, but I have a deduction for dividend. Check the dividend adjustment. I have a proposed dividend, guys, to be deducted from that. How much is the value of dividend? My total dividend paid is 20,000. Now I need to take 4 by 12. Take 4 by 12 dividend. It is 6,000. 6667, correct. So, now find out the profit. This should be deducted, guys. My profit from 1/4 to 31,799. Forgot the dividend part. Yes, now you take it. We get it as 1867 negative. Now check. 1867 into 30%. Which one add, which one deduct? I have to add it at one place, we have to deduct it at the other place. Which one should be added, which one should be deducted? Normally what do we do? If it is a profit, we reduce from post, add to pre. Loss, I'll add to post, I'll reduce from pre. Or 28,240 and 560. Check your cost of control, guys. Cost of acquisition is 1,96,000. Careful with the careful with the pre-acquisition dividends. Very careful with the pre-acquisition dividend. There are two pre-acquisition dividend which you have to consider. One dividend which has been given in the point number 4. On 31/7, dividend at the rate of 10% was received from Ball Limited and credited to P&L. And he clearly said the shares purchased on 31/7 are not entitled to dividend. So I'll receive dividend only on the 8,000 shares which are required on 1,499, which is perfectly pre-acquisition dividend. So this dividend is received pre-acquisition dividend received is on 8,000 shares, each share being 10 rupees, and they received 10%. 8,000 straightforward. But out of the dividend receivable also I have a pre-acquisition dividend. Now he proposed dividend. Now how much is he proposing dividend? He proposed a dividend at the rate of 10% again. Now out of the 10%, I will receive even on this 6,000 shares which were required on 31/7. It is for the full year. But first 4 months I will consider them as pre-acquisition period. So it should be 6,000 shares, each one of 10 rupees, 10% dividend into 4 by 12. Only the first 4 months. Only the first 4 months are considered as pre, balance is post. How much will be this amount? 2,000. This is 1,86,000. Share in net assets. Share capital. 38,000. Share capital 16,000 shares, 1,60,000 share capital. Pre-acquisition reserves 28,240. So this is 188,240. So all in all, I get a capital reserve of 2,240. Check your minority interest then. Their share in net assets, so share capital. He holds 4,000 shares. 40,000 share capital. Their share in the reserves, only pre-acquisition reserve, he does not have a share in post-acquisition. It was zero anyways, 7,200. Do not forget their share in proposed dividend. You have just proposed a dividend, he is also receiving a part of it. What is the proposed dividend? 20,000. His share, 20%, 4,000. Easier way to calculate is 10% of share capital. Directly take 10% of the share capital of 40,000, directly you get the answer. Plenty of adjustment, guys. VAT limited balance of P&L is 50. First is share in post acquisition reserves. Post acquisition reserve of Ball. His share in the post-acquisition reserve of Ball, 560, as it is. Then pre-acquisition reserve, wrongly credited to P&L. Pre-acquisition dividend, last year's dividend, which is wrongly credited to P&L. How much last year's dividend, what is already received? 8,000 rupees. What is the current year dividend receivable? Only post acquisition I have to consider, guys. 8,000 shares completely post acquisition dividend for the current year. 8,000 into 10 into 10%. 8,000 rupees compulsorily post acquisition dividend. But I'm sorry, 8,000 shares have become 10,000 now after the bonus. So this will become 10,000. Then come to that 6,000 which were required on at a later point of time. 10 rupees, 10%, only 8 months is post acquisition. I can't take the full period because 4 months I have already taken here. 4 months I have already considered as pre-acquisition. Balance 8 months I have to consider here. So 8 months dividend will be 4,000 post acquisition. Two more adjustments. One adjustment is Ball Limited's expenses paid. I have paid and I have debited my P&L. Now I have to increase the P&L. How much expenditure? 4,000, which we already deducted from Ball Limited. Now I have to add it to BAT. 4,000. One more proposed dividend. He is also proposing dividend. His proposed dividend on 1,60,000 shares, 10%, 16,000. This is 44,560. Sufficient information to prepare your consolidated balance sheet. Let's try to get the balance sheet right. Small balance sheet, guys. Equity and liabilities. Shareholder funds, share capital, 1,60,000. Reserves and surplus, capital reserve of 2,240. P&L is 44,560. Minority, $51,200. Current liabilities, creditors, no intercompany owings to be cancelled. Straightforward figure, 16. Proposed dividend. $16,000 again. Assets. Non-current assets, tangible fixed assets, there's nothing, there's no intangible assets as well, all we have is only current assets. Debtors 1,20,000. Stock 80,000. Bank 70,000. And finally cash 20,000. Balance sheet totals to 3,90,000. Okay, 290, what is that? $2,90,000.